Good morning. Sorry for that awkward transition. It's because we're going live because we're live streaming, and I don't know if we're actually live streaming. So are we live streaming back there yet? We are live streaming. That's great. Hey, woo! Hey, welcome to Arizona Community Church. My name is Bill. I'm the lead pastor here, and we are starting with baptisms today. So I want to turn your attention to Pastor Brandon in our baptistry, and Brandon, take it away.
Well, good morning, everybody. So glad to be here with y'all this morning. And we get to celebrate baptisms, which is one of the greatest things that we get to do here. It's so awesome just hearing stories of life change, just seeing people who are impacted by the gospel. All the information about the people getting baptized today is going to be in your program, so make sure you check that out. But this here is Marissa. Marissa is going to get baptized today. I'm really excited for you. And Marissa, we're just going to ask you the same question that we ask everybody. Have you accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior in do you believe that Jesus Christ is your Lord and Savior, and have you accepted him as your personal Lord and Savior?
Yes.
Yes, all right. Well, Marissa, we'll have you face this way. And it's my privilege and honor to baptize you in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Woo! There you go. Thanks a lot.
And this here is Bonnie. And Bonnie, same question for you. Do you believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, and have you accepted him as your Lord and Savior?
Yes.
All right. Let's face this way here. There we go. Now, it's my privilege and honor to baptize you in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Last but not least, we have Trevor here. Trevor, same question. Hope you're ready. Do you believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, and have you accepted him as your Lord and Savior?
Absolutely.
All right. Cross your arms for me. Trevor, it's my privilege and honor to baptize you in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Hey, let's open in a word of prayer. Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for those that were baptized. Strengthen their faith, God, and bless us in this service. And we pray these things in your Son's name. Amen. Well, listen, would you do me a big favor to give Valley Christian, their chorale, a big round of applause and welcome this morning.
Sings my soul, my Savior, to see and to hear.
I scarce can take it in.
And sinks my soul, how great thou art.
That on the cross my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. And sinks my soul,
amazing. You guys are in for a treat today. We want to welcome you, all of you that are new with us today. Thank you again for being here. Again, my name is Bill. We want to welcome those that are watching online as well. Just a couple of quick announcements. I do want to say this. Valley Christian was voted one of the top 50 Christian high schools in the nation. I would say it's one of the top high schools in all the nation. Forget Christian. They are amazing in what Valley Christian is doing. What you might not know is that many people that are associated with this church helped found Valley Christian. I think a few of them are here today. Harold Molinar, is he here somewhere? Harold, stand up. Jim Carpenter, is he in here today? I don't know if Jim's in here, so Harold's right there. Now, the man that started this church, that also started Grace Community Church and helped found Valley Christian, is Pastor Guy Davidson. Many of you know him. He recently passed away. Tremendous man. I learned more about how to be a pastor under him than all my seminary training and everything else combined. But we have a treat today because Martha is here today. So Martha, where is Martha today? Where is she? Where is she? She's here somewhere. There she is. Martha Davidson. Can we give her a big round of applause? Martha, thank you so much. Welcome home. Welcome home. We owe you a debt of gratitude. So, hey, listen, one quick announcement. Motorsports Day is coming this Saturday. If you've never been to our Motorsports Day, we are going to have hundreds of cars out here in our parking lot, food trucks. It's a blast. It's free. Bring people down. Just have a great time. Check out all the hot rods. You saw a couple out on the plaza today. It's going to be amazing. So we hope to see you there. So on that note, let's turn it back over.
Good morning, everybody. I'm just going to invite you to stand with us this morning and join us for worship. Let's pray. Heavenly Father God, we thank you for this time that we get to be able to worship you and glorify your name, Jesus. We thank you for what you're going to continue to do throughout this service, God. We have our ears and our hearts and our minds open to what you have to say to us and how you would like to move through us this morning. We pray this all in your name. Amen.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger. The King of glory, the King above all kings, who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life. That I would be set free. Chaos back into order, who makes the orphans a son and daughter, the King of glory, the King of glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love.
That you would take my place.
That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life. That I would be set free.
God, we thank you for the ultimate sacrifice that you made for us, all because of your love, all because of the love that you have for your children. And for that, we praise you. We glorify you, Jesus. We give you all the honor and all the praise. And to that, we say how great you are, how mighty you are, and we lift you high in this place.
The splendor of the King, clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice, all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide. Trembles at his voice, trembles at his voice.
Every voice.
How great is our God. Sing with me, how great. and age to age he stands, and time is in his hands, beginning and the end, beginning and the end. The Godhead three in one, Father, Spirit, Son, the Lion and the Lamb, the Lion and the Lamb. How great is our God! Sing with me, how great is our God!
Guys, may all be seated. Thank you.
Joyful noise to the Lord. Rejoice, let the spirit rejoice, and the
Would you stand with me? Thank you guys so very much. All right, you may be seated. Again, thank you, Valerie. I forgot to mention, this is under the direction of Marianne. Hi, Marianne's right here, so you can just turn, wave, and say thank you to her. Amazing what you guys do over there. I also forgot to mention somebody that helped plant this awesome school, and that is Richard Hatfield, and Josie's here today. Where's Josie? Raise your hand. She's right over there, so she's there. So gosh, it's amazing. God is so good. God is so, so very good. Well, again, we want to welcome you if you're new. If you are new with us, stop by our Welcome Center. We have a gift bag that we want to give to you. If you're new and watching us online, send us an email and let us know. We'd love to send you some information as well. Well, it's a good Sunday to be here, and here's why. We are starting a brand new sermon series today, and it's called Where do I draw the line? Now, I want to warn you. It's a fun-looking little graphic, and it's a fun title, and I think, oh, this is going to be a lighthearted, fun sermon series. It's not. Okay, I'm going to hit hard. And if you're new with us and you don't know me, I like to hit hard. I'm all about the sufficiency of God's word, and I like to preach God's word. And so sometimes we hit a little hard. I know that I find myself asking this question on a regular basis. Where do I draw the line? And I know if I'm asking it, you're asking it. As a matter of fact, people come to me as a pastor all the time, and they're going, Pastor Bill, help me figure out where to draw the line on this issue or that issue. So we're all dealing with this. Now, sometimes answering this question is nice and easy. It's nice and clean. And it's great when it is, isn't it? It's like crystal clear. I know where to draw the line here. But then other times, it's not so easy. It's just like, oh my gosh, what do I do in this particular situation? Now, here's the deal. The question of where to draw the line is even further complicated if you call yourself a Christian. If you call yourself a Christian, then you and I operate from a different set of standards than the world, do we not? Of course we do. And that only adds to sometimes the difficulty of where to draw the line. We are making eternal decisions. We are trying to make decisions that honor God. So it's not like people in the world who are like, well, whatever, no big deal, no harm, no foul. We are trying to make decisions that honor God. We're trying to make eternal decisions. We're trying to draw lines that have eternal consequences. And that is a big, big deal. Thus, we are forced to factor in things that the non-believer doesn't have to. Now, the question of where to draw the line has application in practically every area of our lives. Everything from our relationships to religion to ethics to politics is on the table when we ask this question. I mean, for heaven's sakes, we just went through an intense time in our country where people were literally at each other's throats about where to draw the line when it comes to wearing masks. You know, right? I mean, there were literally fistfights in Targets all across America. Did you see these things on YouTube and on the news? People were breaking out into fights because if you walked in and you were either wearing a mask or not wearing a mask, fights were breaking out. So really, really practical topic to address. And I'm not going to address if you should wear a mask or not. I'll let you just figure out that one on your own. But you see my point. You see my point. So I hope this sermon series is helpful. And I'd like to begin with prayer, so let me pray. Father, as we kick off this series, may it just be something that transforms our lives, transforms our hearts. And God, as we explore this topic and get into your word, God, we pray, God, that you would change us from the inside out. So thank you for each person that is here, each person that is watching online. And God, we know that you're with us. May our hearts be with you. And we pray these things in your son's name. Amen. Amen. So this morning, we're kicking off this series by addressing the issue of where to draw the line in the most important of all areas, and that is our relationship with the Lord. Now, let's address something up front and straight away. This is what needs to be said. And what needs to be said is going to be hard for a lot of us to hear. So brace yourselves. When it comes to our relationship with God, we don't draw the lines. He does. Do I hear an amen? Amen? Amen. God draws the lines. God draws the lines. As a matter of fact, he draws the lines, period, end of sentence. He does. Remember when you had children or grandchildren, if you've even been around kids, you see the kindergartner who brings home their work, and there's lines all over. There's no lines. They're not in the lines. They're not drawing in the lines, but you look at it and you go, this is beautiful, right? Here's the point. Compared to God, we are but kindergartners with crayons trying to draw lines that he alone should draw. We are but kids, kindergartners with crayons compared to God. Now, almost everyone listening to me right now agrees with this. God draws the lines. We all agree with it in principle. In principle, we all agree that God is God. So, of course, he's the one that gets to draw the lines. But while we might agree with this in principle, we struggle with it in reality. I know that I do. I know that I do. And if I do, I know you do. And one of the big reasons I think we struggle with this is because we as human beings have a really bad tendency. You want to know what that tendency is? That tendency is to assume that our relationship with God is more or less like our relationships with everyone else in our lives. We go, yeah, here are my friends and here are my family. And, you know, of course, God's above them. You know, so, but if I were to put it in order, God's at the top, of course, but then right below him and right below them and right below them. Here's the problem with that. God's not just right above us right above our other relationships, he's exceedingly far above all of our relationships, right? The tendency as humans is to say, well, God's kind of good and I'm not so bad. I say this all the time. That is our tendency to say, God's kind of good and I'm not so bad, when in fact God is exceedingly holy and other than we are, and we are exceedingly sinful. We are exceedingly different from God in every way imaginable. God is God, and that means he's in a category all by himself. Listen to what Isaiah says. To whom then will you liken God, or what likeness compare with him? What's the answer? Nothing. Nothing. The answer, of course, is nothing. There is nothing to which you and I can compare God in heaven above or on earth below. As God, that means he holds all the cards. He draws all the lines. And here's the key. If you're willing to embrace this truth, it can and will change your life in ways that you couldn't possibly dare dream about. It will change your life. Now, let's have a moment of honesty. Letting someone else draw the lines is scary, even when that person is God himself, right? As a matter of fact, we might say letting someone else draw the lines is scary, especially when that person is God. I mean, if God is the one drawing the lines, who knows what my life will be like or where I will end up? I'll probably end up in some third world country, for heaven's sakes. God's the one drawing the lines. If God's drawing the lines, I won't be happy in life. I'll probably be miserable. And if God's the one drawing the lines, that means I got to make some tough decisions regarding those lines. These are the questions that scare us when someone else is drawing the line, especially God. Listen, everyone likes to think they trust God. The question is, to what extent do you and I trust God? Everyone is comfortable trusting God to draw some of the lines. Who isn't? Everyone's comfortable with God drawing some of the lines. The question is, will we go all in when it comes to God drawing all the lines? All of them. All of the lines. All of the moral lines. All of the ethical lines. All of the lines regarding the relationships we're in. All of the financial lines. All of the lines regarding our priorities and how we govern our life. Are we all in on that proposition? But again, here's the good news. Once a person goes all in when it comes to trusting the lines that God draws, that person's life with God will never be the same. Your life will never be the same. Everything you know will change, and it will change in a way that you couldn't possibly even imagine. You will never regret when you go all in with the Lord. Do you want to know one of the first things, by the way, that you realize upon accepting that God alone gets to draw the lines? You realize this: there's no one better at drawing lines than God. Amen? Again, compared to God, we are kindergartners with crayons. He's the expert. He's the one that created the universe. He laid out the heavens and set boundaries. He knows how to draw lines, good, good lines. You quickly realize God knows what he's doing, and he's really good at what he does. Every line that God draws is good. Do you realize God has never drawn a bad line? Think about how many bad lines you've drawn in your life. Not just with a pencil. I mean, think about how many messed up lines. How many times have you colored outside the box? Now, think about that morally in every other area of your life. How many times you've drawn bad lines? God has never, ever, ever drawn one bad line, ever. The law of the Lord is perfect. It is perfect, reviving the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure, making wise the simple. God draws perfect lines every time. It's incredible. Think about this. The law of the Lord is perfect, reviving the soul. I shared this in the first hour. When I first became a Christian, I had lived for myself in the world. And when I became a Christian, it was like nourishment to my bones. It really was. Making wise the simple. Boy, that describes me as a 17-year-old kid when I fell in love with the Lord. Listen, if God is perfect and the lines he draws are perfect, then the most perfect decision you or I could ever make is falling in love with the lines that God draws. You see, there's great benefits that come to the person who trusts in the lines that God draws. Do you understand this? There's great benefits. And here's just a couple. Reviving the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure, making wise the simple. Let me take you to another verse that you're all familiar with in Proverbs. Listen to the benefits that come to the person who trusts the lines that God draws. Trust in the Lord with all your heart, and do not lean on your own understanding. In other words, stop trying to draw the lines that God alone should be drawing. Don't trust yourself to draw the lines. You're but a kindergartner with crayons compared to God. In all your ways, acknowledge him, and he will make straight your paths. Be not wise in your own eyes. Fear the Lord and turn away from evil. It will be healing to your flesh and refreshment to your bones. I love this. And he will make straight your paths. Who doesn't want a straight and sturdy path where every footstep you take is sure and steady? Does that sound like a good benefit? That comes to the person and to the person who alone trusts the lines that God draws. It is the person who says, I'm not going to lean on my own understanding. I'm not going to be the one trying to draw the lines that God alone should be drawing. I'm going to trust him with all of my heart, soul, mind, and strength, and he will make every step I take sure and steady. And like, I love what it says. It's just like the last verse. It's like nourishment, refreshment to you. When you obey God, it is so good. I spent the first 17 years of my life eating junk food. Not literal junk food. I mean living in sin, living for myself. And I was worn down and worn out. But when I got saved and I began to feast on the things of the Lord and I began to trust the lines that he was drawing, it was like nourishment to my bones. It was like I was becoming a new creation, a new person that God was forming in and through me. You know, I meet so many people who are miserable simply because they won't submit to the lines that God draws. I've said it before, I'll say it again, the most miserable people in all the world are Christians who try to keep one foot in the kingdom and one foot in the world. And you know how I know that? Because I've been there. I've been there. There have been plenty of times, I've been a Christian 35 years, there's been plenty of times where I'm like, all right, I'm gonna be the one Christian that does this well. I'm gonna put one foot in the kingdom and one foot in the world, and I'm gonna do it better than anybody else. And guess what? It just results in misery. Do you wanna know what should scare you, by the way? As Americans, we're scared about a lot of things. We're scared about our economy. We're scared about foreign entities, everything. We're scared about our future, our kids, you name it, the coronavirus, so on and so forth. Do you know what should really scare you? The thought that somehow you and I know better than God and that we can actually draw better lines than him. That's what should terrify you. I often say this. I often worry about all the wrong things. I will spend my life worrying, and then when I look back on that season of life, it's funny, I go, I was worried about all the wrong things. It's just the nature of, I guess, who I am. I don't know if you do it too, but let me give you a good example. What should scare you is not the economy or what's happening in China or Russia or any other foreign country. What should scare you is that you and I somewhere deep down think that we can draw better lines than God. Folks, we are but kindergartners with crayons in the presence of a God whose law is perfect and whose testimony is sure, who's never drawn a bad line in his life. This is who we are. That is the thought that should keep you awake at night. So here's the deal. Let's get practical. Where are some of the places we see God drawing very clear lines that people have a hard time accepting? Now, this is the whole sermon series, by the way. The reason I start with this message is because all the subsequent messages are going to be based on this one principle. God gets to... Say it with me. Draw the lines. You got to be firm on this foundation because we're going to build on it in the weeks to come. But let's get practical. Where are some areas where we see this? Let me give you some of the big ones. Ironically, one of the key areas we see people struggling with the lines that God has clearly drawn is when it comes to the issue of God himself. God alone gets to draw the lines defining who he is. Listen, ask the average person in America to define who God is. What will they say? They will describe for you a God that they have made up in their own minds and according to their own imagination. In many cases, this will be the case. What might even be more tragic is I've been in many conversations with people where I have talked to them describing the God of the Bible, and upon hearing about that God, Their response is, if that is the God of the Bible, I want nothing to do with him. Perhaps you've been in such conversations as well. Sadly, such people really only want to follow a God whom they get to define by the lines they personally get to draw. You want to know what the problem with that is? The problem is you end up with a God who doesn't exist. When you draw the lines defining who God is, you have just created a God that doesn't exist. Well done. And a God who doesn't exist is a God who doesn't save. A God who doesn't exist is a God who doesn't save. Not only do you end up with a God who doesn't exist, you have now crossed a line that God has clearly drawn, and a line that the line you have crossed is that of idolatry. You don't want to cross that other line, by the way. Here's a great example of a line that God has clearly drawn. Church, hear the word of God. Exodus chapter 20. By the way, where are the two places where the Ten Commandments are found? Exodus chapter 20, Deuteronomy chapter 5. Exodus chapter 20, Deuteronomy chapter 5. And God spoke all these words saying, I am the Lord your God who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself a carved image or any likeness of anything that is in heaven above or that is in earth, the earth beneath or that is in the water under the earth. You shall not bow down to serve them, to them or serve them. Listen, could it be any more clear than this? God's saying, stop, don't even try to draw lines. Don't even start. When it comes to me, I define who I am. Don't build anything, make anything, draw anything at all, anywhere. And it's like in heaven above, even under the ocean, no matter where you could go, don't draw whatever you see and say it's me, because it's not. Think about the tragedy, folks, of spending your entire life believing in a God that doesn't exist. Yet this is exactly what we see happening here in America and really just across this planet of ours. This is what happens when people assume they are the ones who get to draw the lines defining who God is and who he isn't. John 4:24, you know it well, God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. In truth, and here's the key, guys, if you are not worshiping God in truth, you are not worshiping God at all. At all. I hate to say it, you can go ahead and make a God according to your own imagination. You can draw the lines, but that's not a God that exists. If you're not worshiping God in truth, you're not worshiping God at all. Who is the God that exists in the minds of most Americans? Here he is. He's a God who is all loving, but not all that holy. He is a God who's full of grace, but almost no truth. It's a God who loves everyone and judges no one, and he's a God that's not to be feared. This is the God that exists in the minds of most Americans. Sadly, it's a God that doesn't exist. Americans are perhaps the most empowered people on this planet. You realize that. You know that. Our forefathers founded a great country and forged for us freedoms that the rest of the world can only dream about. We have rights. We have a say. We get to vote. We are an empowered people. We live in a culture where the consumer is always right. And that's a blessing from God to have such freedoms. But with such blessings comes a word of caution. And that caution is this, is that we take this sense of empowerment into our relationship with God. And we approach the throne of God thinking we have a vote. We have a say. We have rights. Listen, folks, when it comes to your relationship with God, it is not a democracy. It is a theocracy. God is in control. And he alone gets to draw the lines. He holds all the cards. He holds all the power. And again, we have to build on this truth because if you don't get this, the rest of the series is going to be difficult to accept. When it comes to our relationship with God, the only one who is truly empowered is God. That's it. You may have been empowered by this country and the freedoms that you have, but when you walk into the throne room of God, set that aside and remember who you are approaching. You are approaching the one true God that exists in unapproachable light, who is holy beyond your wildest imagination. And anyone, by the way, in the scripture, whoever saw God, what? Fell down as though dead. Remember who you are walking into the presence of him. Fear him. He is holy. So holy that in Isaiah chapter 6, right? Remember Isaiah chapter 6, the seraphim are flying before the Lord. And it says the seraphim had six wings. With two they covered their faces, with two they covered their bodies, and with two they flew. And they cried, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty." Why is this description in the Bible? Again, I've said it before. It is as if the very angels that were created to fly in the presence of God can barely stand to be there because he's so majestic and so holy that they must cover themselves. God's got all the power. He has all the say. He has all the rights. He gets to draw all the lines. That is the God of the Bible. Amen? That's the God you want to follow. You don't want to follow a weak, passive God who doesn't know where to draw the lines and leaves it up to you. No, that's not a God you want to follow, and that is certainly not the God of the Bible. You either come to him according to the lines he has drawn, or you do not come at all. If you are not worshiping God in truth, you are not worshiping him at all. Whatever you do, do not spend your life believing in a God who doesn't exist. I don't know, with this many people in this room right now and those watching online, I don't know where you all are in your walk with God, but if you have been the one drawing the lines defining who God is, I tell you today, stop drawing and come to the God of the Bible. Come to him as he has drawn the lines on his terms. Let me give you another practical example of a place where we see God drawing very clear lines that people often have a hard time accepting. Not only does God get to draw the lines about who he is, he also gets to draw the lines regarding who we are. Who we are. Now, there is a very dangerous view circulating around that as human beings, we are all children of God. It just feels so wonderful to say that, doesn't it? As a matter of fact, in this culture, to say otherwise, you'll be canceled. You will. I bet you, I'll probably be canceled for this in some way, some small way. Somebody will see this and will be offended at the fact that, no, we're all children of God. Now, I think that part of this comes from the fact that the Bible makes it very clear that as human beings, we are all created in the image of God, right? But what people fail to realize is that being created in the image of God does not automatically make you a child of God. As a matter of fact, the Bible goes out of its way to make crystal clear that there's no one righteous, no, not one. One of my favorite, I'm always quoting Romans 3. If you want to know kind of my heart, just go to Romans 3. This will be a good start of where my heart is. None is righteous, no, not one. No one understands, no one seeks for God. All have turned aside, together they have become worthless. No one does good, not even one. As the famous theologian said, the only thing that you bring to your salvation is the sin that made it necessary. That is all you have to offer God. You have no righteousness apart from Christ at all. Do you realize that? And that's why I say when we think that, well, God's kind of good and I'm not so bad. No, 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 no. God is exceedingly holy. He exists in unapproachable light and you have nothing. You bring nothing to the table except the sin that made it necessary. You have no righteousness at all, right? All of our righteous deeds are as filthy rags before the Lord. This is, again, in your thinking and with your families, by the way, you can never make this gap wide enough. At your very best, always never let your family lower God even in the slightest. And whatever you do, don't let them raise themselves in the slightest. You keep that there for your family and for your friends. No matter who you are, you keep that distance where it should be. God infinitely holy, we not so much. Amen. Now, most people are going to immediately recoil at this verse, and they're going to say, of course, come on, I'm not that bad of a person. They're going to go, I may not be great, but I'm certainly not down here. I'm up here a little bit. The problem is, you and I don't get to draw the lines when it comes to this issue. God does. So we're living in fascinating times. You want to know why it's fascinating? Because we're living in a culture where now people can identify themselves as whatever they want. Incredible. It's incredible that we are here. If someone identifies themselves in a particular way, we are being told to accept it without question, because if you don't accept it without question, you're an oppressor, you're a bigot, you're gonna be canceled. Accept it. Why is this important? Here's why. You might like to identify yourselves as a good person, but you're not. Nor am I, apart from Christ. Apart from Christ, we can say, well, I'm not a bad person. Says who? You? When did you get to draw the lines with regard to this issue? I think I recall the Bible having to say a thing or two about who God is and who we are. And when it comes to those two issues, guess who gets to draw the lines? God does. God gets to draw the lines. Listen, whatever you do, everyone in here, shake some people. Whatever you do, never lose sight of the fact that even though the U.S. government might give you the right to identify yourselves as whatever you want, God does not. Amen? Amen? We do not take our cues from the U.S. government. We take our cues from the scriptures where God has spoken clearly. And what God says we are, who we are, and what we are, that's what we are. Period. End of sentence. Just as God gets to draw the lines as to who he is, he gets to draw the lines when it comes to who we are. And according to God's word, who we are isn't all that good. It isn't good at all. You want to know how bad it is? This is how bad it is. Listen to what Paul says to the church in Ephesus. And you were dead in the trespasses of your sins, in which you once walked, following the course of this world, following the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that is now at work in the sons of disobedience. Let me ask you a question. Before you became a Christian, did you ever think of yourselves as following demonic spirits? Bet you didn't, but you did. According to this, you did. So did I. Among whom we all once lived. That means you and me. That means you and me. In the passions of your flesh, carrying out the desires of the body and the mind, and were by nature children of God. Is that what it says? Children of wrath. We were children of wrath. Yes, we are created in the image of God. Yes, we are image bearers, but that does not automatically make you a child of God. We are children of wrath, like the rest of mankind. Folks, the lines laid down in this passage alone sting. They sting because they take a shot at the very thing that we're good at, and that is being prideful. Lifting ourselves up as having something to bring to the table with our relationship with God when we bring nothing at all. Nothing at all. But I want you to notice that Paul is talking in the past tense in this passage, is he not? And that is because the lines that once defined the Christians in Ephesus no longer exist. And that is because God in his mercy sent his one and only Son into the world to erase the old lines and create new ones. That's the great thing about our God. He gets to draw the lines, and if he decides, hey, we're going to fix this line and put a new line over here, guess who has the prerogative to do that? He can, yeah, that's what the scriptures say. He is the God in heaven that can do whatever he wants, whenever he wants. And that leads to our final point this morning, and it is simply this. God draws the lines about how people are saved. God draws the lines about who he is, who we are, and how people are saved. Now, just as there is a mistaken idea that we are all children of God, there is also a mistaken idea out there. And listen, I know you all know this because I'm going to test you right now. Ready? All roads lead to heaven or lead to God, right? All roads. You know it. You know it so well that I just have to prompt you and you can finish it. Once again, this is a classic example of mankind trying to draw lines that we have no authority to draw whatsoever. God gets to define who he is, who we are, and how people are saved. And according to God, there is only one way to be saved, one way and one way only. And there is salvation in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved. Jesus himself stressed this truth. He said, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. I know every one of you in here that is a believer today, you have encountered people who have told you, certainly, other people, other ways, there's a lot of ways to God. Who gets to define that? Who gets to draw that line? Them? Me? You? No, God gets to draw that line. And he has drawn that line to one single person in history, and that is his son, Jesus Christ. And immediately people are going to recoil and go, well, that's offensive. How dare you say that there is only one way to heaven? I say this all the time. If you're new with us or if you're watching online, I say this all the time. What should shock you isn't that there's only one way to heaven. What should shock you is that there's a way at all. God owes us nothing. See, that's a fundamental problem we have. The minute you think God owes you something, anything, you're off on the wrong foot. God owes you nothing but justice and wrath. And if you don't know that, you don't know the God of the Bible. And you don't understand the depravity of mankind. You don't understand just how holy he is and how depraved we are in our sins. God owes us nothing at all. He doesn't owe us life, happiness, joy. He doesn't owe us anything. The fact that he sent his one and only sinless son into the world to die for the sins of mankind is the greatest act of mercy this world has ever seen. He gets to define the lines. And those lines all point to one person in history, that is Jesus Christ as the Savior of the world. Listen, the important thing for each of us here today and as we move forward in this sermon series is that we are crystal clear that in our relationship with God, God, say it with me, God draws the lines. God draws the lines. And by the way, the important thing is, again, isn't do I trust God? Everyone trusts God to draw some of the lines. The question is, will you go all in for him to be the one that draws all the lines in your life? All the lines. That means all the lines regarding the relationships you're in, the attitudes you have, the choices that you make. He gets to draw all the lines about what is right and wrong. Do you trust him enough to draw all the lines? I'm going to say something, and I don't know why I was burdened to say this. I said it last night at our Saturday night service, but I want to speak to the men in here right now. Men, do you want to know what courage is? If you're looking to the world to know what courage is, you're looking in the wrong place. Courage is the man that goes all in and trusts God to draw the lines. And it's the same for women, but I want to speak to the men. What is courageous is a man who leads his family, who leads his friends, who leads with the courage of conviction to say that God draws the lines and no matter what, no matter the cost to me, I'm going to follow. And I'm going to live by those lines and live in those lines. Why? Because it's nourishment to my soul. No one draws better lines than God. If you want to be a man of courage in this generation, go all in. If there is an area of your life, men, where you are holding out, where God doesn't have authority, where he has drawn lines, but you are crossing that line, today submit and give him that area or those areas. And it goes for the women in here as well. The most beautiful woman, the most beautiful women, according to Proverbs 31, is what? The woman of God. The woman who's all in, who trusts God. She's good. She's good for her husband, right? A godly wife, who can find? She's worth more than all the riches in the world. Men, if you want to be courageous, go all in. Women, if you want to be beautiful, go all in. God is large and in charge. He's drawn all the lines. The question for you and I is, will we trust and obey? This is what it comes down to. Will we trust and obey? Listen, folks, you don't want it any other way. God knows what he's doing. Trust him. So if I may be so bold to finish with a question, here it is. Is there an area of your life where you need to start trusting God and the lines that he has clearly drawn? Amen? Will you pray with me? Father in heaven, we come before you. And Lord, we are so thankful that you are a God that speaks. You speak with conviction. And God, you are a God that has not left your creation without wisdom or knowledge. God, you have drawn clear lines, and we look to your word, and we know, and we learn there that your law is perfect. God, forgive us of the times in which we have drawn our own lines. Perhaps we're in a place in our life right now where we're doing just that. God, forgive us, and help us, God, to trust you, to draw all the lines. Help us to submit, even when it's hard, even when we don't know what the full ramifications are going to be for us. God, may we trust and obey no matter the cost to us. In the quietness of your heart, and if you're watching online, just a moment of private prayer. Come to the Lord and ask him to search your heart and ask him to help you to go all in. Father, we thank you and we love you. And I pray for these students, these Valley students over here, God, this next generation that you are raising up, God, that you would raise them up to be more courageous, more bold, more on fire than this generation could ever dare dream about. God, that they would do more before you than even us. God, bless them and go before them and give them the courage to follow you with all of their heart. So, Father, we love you. We thank you, and we pray these things in your son's name. And everybody said with me, amen. Hey, one more round of applause for Valley Christian, please. You guys are awesome. Hey, we will see you out on the plaza, donuts and coffee. God bless you.